So what are ecofeminism or ecological feminism? No, it's a part of it's a concept coined by this woman, Françoise de Bonne, a French woman that became popular in the context of many struggles against environmental destruction. I don't know where my, sorry. I can't read the screen, sorry, because I have the your faces here and I cannot read it very much. I cannot move it either. Oh. Okay, I'll survive. So basically, at the end of the 70s, it was created as a hybrid, no, of different social movements that were the environmental movement, the peace movement, and also the struggle for animal rights, for animal liberation, that was also sparkling at that decade, well, at different levels, no, in different forms. Basically, the ecological feminisms are saying the main thing is that they are recognizing that there's an ecological crisis, that by then, by the 1970s, that there was some evidence that we were kind of in trouble. So they are recognizing and assuming that there is a global ecological crisis and that this is a feminist issue. No? So they are saying that the same way that for instance, housing is a feminist issue, no? Because if the prices of houses are very high, this affects the lives of women, no? Women that have to live with their partners that beat them up, the struggle for housing is a feminist issue. The struggle to maintain the conditions that sustain life on the planet is also a feminist issue, because mostly there's millions of women heavily impacted by this crisis, and also this crisis is created with different kind of forces that are fed through very problematic hierarchical and masculine values, you know, that are driving this ecological crisis. So what they say is that there are significant connections between the subordination and oppression of women and other social groups, other like subaltern marginal social groups such as indigenous people, black and colored people, or the I don't know how to say it in English, LGBTIQ people, and the exploitation and domination of nature. No, they see these connections. No, they see that the condition, the different sorts of oppression, of social oppression, there's an underneath cross-cutting layer in which nature is involved and how the human nature perception operates. No, let me see if I can. Yeah. So let's start with the first thing. No. So what is the situation? No. They assume that there is a global ecological crisis. With the creation of the ecofeminisms in the late 70s, there were people who already saw that. Now, like 50 years later, this situation has worsened dramatically. No, this is the latest graphic compiled by the people of the Stockholm. I didn't write it well. Stockholm Resilience Center, and they divided that as a way to say to try to reflect in which what is the situation of our life support system of the earth, of the earth. They identified 9 planetary boundaries that mark a safe operating space for humanity on the planet. So here you can see that these nine boundaries are this one: climate change, freshwater change, stratospheric ozone depletion, atmospheric aerosol loading, ocean acidification, biochemical flows, novel entities, land system change, and biosphere integrity, which means the crisis of extinction. So basically, what we see, or what the empirical evidence we have right now, and this is exactly from like 1 week ago, because a boundary, the green water, the water has been kind of measured somehow. It's saying that we are kind of in a trouble, and we are exceeding safe limits in at least 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of these boundaries. And there's the boundaries, we don't really know what's going on. So, so basically this is saying that we are, yeah, we are triggering, we are facing very likely irreversible change. No, it's we are living in an truly extraordinary times of history. No, in which we've pushed the planet to a different state, and that has dramatic consequences for all the living fabric. So basically the ecofeminism assume this is like the, and they articulate this with the feminist struggle. These are also other indicators, like, well, it is said by some people we live in the Anthropocene or Capitalocene, no? It's like this new geological epoch in which humanity, or some people of the humans, have pushed the planet to this different state. And we have here, and it's been accelerating from the 1950s dramatically, no? And this has consequences in a very material way, no, for the conditions the biophysical conditions that support life in all its forms. So ecofeminism's here a technical break. We call it ecofeminism because it's an umbrella term. In reality, there's different ways of understanding this or like grounding these beliefs. It's good to talk in plural because there's different ways to ground the different ecofeminisms. There's different assumptions, there are different groups of ecofeminists put different emphasis on some things and some others. And it's good to recognize this plurality of forms. So ecofeminisms, to me, are a response to the Anthropocene, no? Because industrialist patriarchy is identified as a main driving force of the global ecological crisis, and it's sustained by four pillars. I'm gonna go very quick because I don't want it to be like a very theoretical talk. So, and if you want, we can talk more, but otherwise it's like a pew. It's like I'm just drawing very quickly. So this is the industrialist patriarchy sustained by four pillars. The first one is a globalized industrial and productivist economy. The second is a mechanistic vision of the world. Well, no, the global industrial and productivist economy, what does is commodifying life itself, makes like perversion of products. We stop asking ourselves about the nature of processes and products. We stop asking where everything goes or how it's been done, or what's needed for this to be in our hands. It's based on productivism and the myth of unlimited growth, no? The belief that increased production is intrinsically good. And there's no questions about limits, redistribution, or consequences. It creates cannibal economies sustained by using other people's bodies or other lands or the elements of life. And it's based on an invisibilization and devaluation. Sorry, I think it corrects my translation. Of all the human and non-human work needed to sustain life, no? It invisibilizes all socio dependencies, no? The fact that we are social dependent beings, and we are also ecological dependent beings. No? We depend on a fabric of ecological relations and social relations to be here now, alive. So the second pillar is this mechanistic vision of the world. A mechanistic vision of the world means that it's not only an economy that has brought us to this situation. It's also, there's a very important role of what science, and more specifically technoscience, has done in the construction of this current model of domination of nature, and we are here because science has played also an important role. So basically, patriarchy also needed a hierarchical vision of living beings who are more worthy than who are less worthy. And science, positivist science, most accurately, offered one, distorting the profound bonds of continuity between the humans and the rest of the living beings. So that happened in the 16th century with the triumph of the world machine vision, no? In the world, to see the world not as a living creature. Well, now there's contested theories, but at that moment there was a vision started dominating others. And this vision was the vision of the world as a machine, no? A machine that can be, whose parts are replaceable. So you can cut a rainforest and make a plantation because it's trees and trees. They only see trees. They don't see the complexity. And that makes that starting conceptualizing nature, and that has passed in the, obviously I'm talking about the privileged rich world, nature started being conceived as a background, no? Where human issues happen, no? Nature as a background, as a passive thing, as a submissive, as controllable, as always available there for exploitation and deployment. So that's the mechanistic vision of the world. The third pillar is this set of hierarchical values associated with the human nature divide, what's called the hierarchical dualisms. And this permeates, this is related to a very deep part of our culture, in which different categories are associated with different value. And there's a set of categories related to nature or more explicit or less explicit that are placed in a different, that are given different values in society, no? And in that value, there's one pair in those categories, those pairs, there's one that has more power, more supremacy, and more priority, no? So we can see here, if I read the blue ones, it's like the ones that are more have more supremacy, no? Over the green ones, no? So culture over nature, reason over nature, male over female, mind over body, sir over slave, rationality over animality, reason over emotion, freedom over necessity, universal over particular, human over, I don't see because I have you there, see that's bad. Human over nature, I guess, or non-human nature, civilized.
Primitive, should I read it out?
Yeah, read it because I don't know.
Production, reproduction, yeah. Public over private, subject over object, heterosexual over queer, oneself over the other, urban over rural, and adult over child.
So this dualism capitalism act, are constantly acting and giving more value to different realities in which we associate some of these pairs to different realities, and that happen. Okay. I'm sorry, I'm having a little problem with my computer. I know. No puede pasar. No, I don't. Now it doesn't move. Sorry.
Don't worry. It's stressful.
Ooh, wow. Okay. So the fourth one is the fourth one. Yeah. A culture of violence and domination. So here, I'm sorry, I was translating and then the program translated back. So the culture of domination and violence is, well, I don't know, expression and reproductive. I don't understand why the program did that. So basically is an expression of domination and abuse of nature, often with violence, and also violence against bodies, against the lives of a wide range of living beings, including humans. No? This violence can be direct on bodies, that it can be structural violence through institution and social construction, and it can also be symbolic violence. And the consequence of this, many times, the consequence of this symbolic violence, for instance, is the naturalization of this violence. We don't even see that spraying a field full of pesticides is profoundly violent against life, no? It's a violence against life. So we don't even see that, no? in many ways. So these are like the four pillars of the industrialist patriarchy. So basically, ecofeminisms, as a response to the Anthropocene, they align with the claims that the modern project of infinite growth is over. We need to overcome this belief, and we need to reinvent what good life means within the biophysical limits. They link the emancipation or the liberation of women and other subaltern groups to a profound change of the human and human nature relations, and also a profound change over the relation between humans and the planet itself. And basically, having survival options imply changing the dominant patterns of organization and social thought that have led us to the current situation. And that means to radically change and urgently change the social, economic, cultural, and political structures. So that's like the few things of the ecofeminism. I don't know, and I ask very if maybe it's worth to make like a stop here, a brief stop, and ask for, are you following? Do you have questions?
I have the sense that maybe we can go on, if that's okay with others, and then we just take all the time afterwards to have a long conversation.
Okay. So next one. So now we jump to the food system. It's like a little bit of a jump. So the food system, no? The food system, as you know, we all eat food. Food is not only a biological need, but it's also a profoundly social aspect of our lives, social and cultural. We all eat food, and it's a right, and it's an amazing element that brings us together, that celebrates life, that celebrates connections. It's in different cultures, so it's a very interesting element to look into and to see and to study, basically. So when we talk about the food system, we mean this interconnected web of activities, resources, and people that extends across all domains involved in providing human nourishment and sustaining health, including production, processing, packaging, distribution, marketing, consumption, and disposal of food. And right now, our dominant food system is profoundly problematic. It's one of the big drivers of the global ecological crisis. And it needs to change. The food system is responsible only in the climate we were seeing, the nine boundaries. The food system is involved in at least six of them. And in the one on the climate crisis, basically it's responsible of being between a quarter and a third of the global greenhouse gas emissions. So basically, and also without substantial changes in the ways we produce, transport, consume, and dispose food, these emissions are set to increase by 2050. And right now we don't actually see any substantial change at this level. The food system also is not only causing, like, it's not only one of the drivers of, for instance, the climate crisis, also one of the impacted areas, no? In the sense that the climate crisis also will affect how we can produce dramatically, will affect how we produce food. Ay, sorry. Nanook, estoy en una trucada. No. Nanook, estoy en una trucada. No, no, ahora no se puede menjar cuñapé. Va. Nanook, estoy en una trucada. Estoy trabajando. ¿Ves? Te menjas una poma.
Una food. The food always.
I'm sorry.
he wants to eat. No, that's the question.
He wants to eat. He wants
very
to
eat. Appropriate.
A piece of bread. So basically, what cities have to do with all it, with the food system? I work as a since two and a half years ago, I got a position in like an institution that is called the Plan Estratégic Metropolità de Barcelona. It's called the Metropolitan Strategic Plan of Barcelona. And the job is to work for or link to the Barcelona City Council in a project that tries to locate food policies or urban food policies at the center of the social and political agenda. Basically, the topic of urban food policies has until relatively recently been very marginalized from the local government agendas. Partially because at the level of competencies of the things you can do, cities do not really have most of the power to change the most important things, like, for instance, production. They know it's normally in an upper level of governance in which that power relies. No? In Europe, that would go up to the European Commission, no? With the Common Agricultural Policy. But then there's the states have a saying, and then in Spain, at least, the regions have a saying. And that's where that power relies. No? Cities, especially big cities, barely they don't have any kind of, or they have little land, so they cannot promote realistically enough, like agricultural projects to feed the city itself. Also, the concept of feeding cities, that cities feed themselves, is a bit problematic. Cities have at least medium and big cities. It's another sort of technological utopia in a way, but the reality is that cities are connected to other areas, rural areas, peri-urban areas. They are connected with links of continuity and interdependency. And when we talk about cities in the urban area, we need to think of farmers in rural areas, and what we eat in the city dramatically affects beyond the realm of the city, basically. So despite not having a lot of competencies, nearly 80% of the food produced in the world is consumed in urban areas. 55% of the global population actually currently lives in cities. And then there's a lot of to do. There's a lot of room to do in all that entails make accessible good food, like work on the commercialization side, on the accessibility, and on cultural change and the consumption side, basically. No, no, cultural change and consumption side. So that's a little bit the what cities can and are doing in the realm of urban food policies. In my project, and I talk from my experience, what was Barcelona, for instance, didn't have any kind of, in the government, the local government didn't have an area of food policies until 2015. The department was created at that moment, but there was not a technician working on that. So that means that you have like a department, but there's no, it's like a ghost department. There's nobody there. There's no resources allocated there. So until 2018, there was nobody really working on the topic. So that's 3 years ago. And then Barcelona is a big city and you have to compete with other departments that maybe are more important in the sense that the city can do more, no? For instance, mobility, no? The mobility of the city. The local government has the competencies, no? Or the urbanism, no? Or like how the city grows, no? The city has the competencies. So what was done was to create a project to take advantage of international leverage, like for instance, in specific, the Milan Urban Food Policy Pact, which is the first international treaty on the topic of sustainable food and healthy food, that is like an alliance of cities that are committed to work to improve food in their cities, and to use this as a push, as an excuse to make like a bigger project. So basically, the city. No way. Okay. The city won a bid to host the 7th Forum of the Milan Urban Food Policy Pact. And then from that, it created a project in which it started developing more projects on sustainable food, for instance, in the canteens of schools, for instance, in the municipal market, public markets. Barcelona has a network of 39 infrastructure like markets that are public, that is public infrastructure that allows to bring food to most of the neighborhoods. So it started trying to do like projects that tried to counterbalance the power of industrial agriculture. And it started doing like last year was the year, they call it the capital of the sustainable food capital, Barcelona World Sustainable Food Capital. The whole year was full with cultural events on sustainable food. And that was a little bit the intention. And at the end of the year, there was a food strategy starting for the next, a participative process with the most of the important stakeholders to set up the common strategic goals for the next 8 years. So this all sounds great, no? Like, wow, it's great. From in my view, although it's very aligned, or it could be potentially aligned with an ecofeminist policy or ecofeminist approach, the reality is that it's not really articulated from that side. No, there was always a tension between working with the people who are already kind of in the paradigm of we need to transform the food system radically and urgently. People who are that are working with agroecology, with food sovereignty in that kind of framework, and also the tension of saying like, do we want to work with the with the people who know the thing, which are very little, or we want to try to expand and to involve more people, even if they are not so, if they don't have such a critical discourse, if they don't have such a critical, analysis, no, of the situation. So it was chosen the second one. That's why it was a sustainable food capital. It was not the agroecological capital or the food sovereignty capital. And that allowed to include much more people and also diluted a little bit the kind of the aims. No? At the end of the year, if we look into ecological indicators, like what has the city advanced, like have, it's not completely clear that in ecological terms, for instance, the progression is so great. And that's kind of, and for me, it's a little bit, well, it makes me like have like a lot of internal thought and internal dilemmas of what's the point. I don't know if, so I will finish by also putting on the table some reflections. Some of the most problematic issues, like one of the most thorny issues is the issue of the cattle farming and the need to reduce meat consumption, which is basically is backed up by empirical data, because all the traders in the markets or like the meat industry like is constantly kind of with any kind of saying like we need to slightly reduce whatever, they kind of reply and write letters to the mayor saying they have to delete these, they have to change these, that's not true. So there's like a kind of a battle there. And one of the things that that I've realized that I've missed the most is like critical voices or articulated critical voices from social movements that can also counterbalance, you know, these voices. This hasn't really happened much, not on this topic. It does happen in, for instance, in more the need of promoting farmers markets, in that it does exist like a social movements that are saying that. But I recently went to a talk in which there was a presentation of a booklet of a magazine that was done by a quite prestigious group here that I respect a lot, and they were like ecofeminist demands, no? Ecofeminist demands from grassroots groups. No, linked to different aspects of society, no? And what was surprising for me is that when they set the demands, it was not really, I didn't see much the ecofeminist connection, no? So for me, it was when they talked about food, for instance, they didn't mention the hot potato of industrial animal farming, which is like a hot potato, but it's a must in a future. It's something that we need to address. Talking on energy, they only focused on redistribution of energy, but they never mentioned, for instance, the need to abandon fossil fuels or leave it in the ground that connect with indigenous struggles. So for me, and that was a little bit the thinking, no, like what makes an ecofeminist demand ecofeminist, no? Or what makes a demand ecofeminist, no? So for me, the same way that you can argue that housing is a feminist issue because how it impacts the life of women, you can argue that different demands, no, the need to transition to organic farming or a pesticide-free or biocide-free way of production, it's a feminist issue because we need to protect the fabric of life as a way of sustaining life itself, that's not for non-human beings. I mean, you can find a lot of argumentation, but the work relies on making this articulation. So maybe the demands are already known, but the what makes an ecofeminist demand is one, the connection between the reference with a biophysical element of life. For instance, it's useful to take the reference of these the nine boundaries. And the second one is this articulation on how it affects women's and other subaltern groups' lives, and how. And for me, this is, I mean, for me, it was useful to think it like that.